Morning, sir. So we are live. So this is Abhay from Manu Patra. Thank you for joining us in this webinar on professional ethics and whistleblowing by Mr. Amitabh Banerjee. So Manu Patra, you might be familiar with us. We have been in the online legal research space since 2001. Our software uses technologies like artificial intelligence, natural language processing, and visualization tools to make let me begin again. So you might be familiar with Manu Patra. Manu Patra, we are an online legal search research tool. We use online technologies like virtual, artificial intelligence, visualization tools to make legal search much more faster, easier, and simpler. I, on behalf of Manu Patra, extend a warm welcome to our presenter today, Mr. Amitabh Banerjee. Mr. Banerjee is a man of many traits. A corporate governance professional, an ICMCSist, independent director, visiting faculty at various prestigious institutions like IIT Delhi, Symbiosis Institute, Pune, among others. A speaker and an author with over a decade experience. I'm sure that you will be able to derive much value and insights from his lecture today. We've also received a lot of questions from you guys in the registration form. So we have tried to incorporate almost all of them in the webinar today. Also, at the end of it, there is going to be a test. We have shared the link with you in the email invite. If you don't have the link, no worries. We'll share it again at the end of the webinar. For all those who score more than 60%, we'll give you a certificate. So without further ado, let me request Mr. Banerjee to share with us his insights on the topic.
So thank you very much. And a very good morning to all of you. But before I start my presentation, I would like to share two thoughts on how we should proceed with the...
So you can share your screen now.
I'll share the screen after a while. So I just wanted to share two thoughts before we begin. So first is, we are in a time when the entire universe has been reset. Everything has to be started from scratch. First proposition to you is, during the session, you will see a lot of videos, you will see a lot of case laws which happened in the past. Now, as lawyers, we know that precedents have a very binding effect on how law is to be made in future. But let me tell you, based on your questions, and there were marvelous questions. I was so happy to receive those questions because they were right on track. So there were questions like whether, RTI Act is actually fulfilling its purpose, whether whistleblowing is of any use or not. So during the presentation, you will see maybe some facts which are quite negative in nature. But at the same time, as professionals, it is our job to find out how you can solve a problem. And that is the entire reason why we are having this session today. Whistleblowing is not a problem, it is a solution. And today, when you are through with the presentation, you will know that there have been 10 instances of failures, but there has been one success story. And that is why we professionals work on and work hard. The second proposition is, I think maybe most of you would have seen the movie Slumdog Millionaire. Now, if you recall the main character, Jamal, he was a common person and he was never brought up in a very educated kind of an environment like we are. But he did win the quiz and he did get the prize money. Now, if you recall how he did it, just try and go to a flashback for those who have seen it. He used to answer every question by relating it to some fact. He used to answer the questions when he was asked a question, he used to recall some facts. Like who invented the gun? He used to recall what somebody said. And then he used to put them in places and then come up with an answer. The human brain actually has to work like that. Because when you are a student, you are given huge knowledge. But when you are out in the world, either in practice or in a job, you are only expected to deliver solutions. When I was an employee in a very well-known company, and I still have the bad habit of opening books, and I am still carrying a book with me right now, just in case, you know, I make a mistake, I'll flip it open in front of you and read out. So this was my basic character. So one fine day I was reading through a book, and the senior vice president saw me doing that. And I was very casual that I was reading a book. So she told me that, Amitav, are you confused about something? I said, no, ma'am, I'm just reading, because this is a provision which is quite complicated. And she told me, you know, a professional should only open a book when he does not know something or when he's confused. Now, this is the standard that you are going to see in the outside world. Hence, webinars or maybe sessions like this help you to create that bridge between knowledge and application. So just like Jamal, all of you, I repeat, all of you will be sitting on the hot seat, either in your office or in front of your client or in front of the judge or the jury or whatever. You all will be sitting on the hot seat, and then you have to correlate your knowledge with the practical situation. Only then you can win the lottery. So with these two propositions in mind, let us start what I have to share. Now, this is a personal experience that I've gathered over around 16 years. I started with ITC Limited way back in 2004. And it's been 16 years, amazing. I still recall ITC like yesterday, but yes, with 16 years, I've been able to understand something of the corporate world, something of the legal practice, something of how commerce works. And that is all I want to share with you. So let us begin with the presentation now. And in between, I'll be seeking your help through some polls also, so that you can share your views on what you think. So let's begin the presentation. As we know that the topic is something which is evergreen. Like if you've seen in the, on the website itself, it says whether or not it's a COVID situation, you will have to go through ethics. You will have to make a decision on ethics. So let's start with something which is very relevant today. More so because you have Mahabharata and Ramayana again coming back to our TV screens. So I thought I should start with that, because most of you, I am sure, would be either watching it or maybe you are passive viewers. It must be on when it comes on the TV. So my character to start with was Karna. As we all know, Karna was a very, very professional warrior. He was one of the most blessed warriors that we know. Yet, somewhere or the other, we glorify Arjun more than him. There were certain adversities which Karna had to face in his life. Even though he was born in a very royal family, but yet Kunti could not declare it to the world. So given this background, when he went to Guru Dronacharya, who was the royal teacher, for seeking knowledge, he simply refused, because he only used to teach people who belonged to the warrior tribe called the Kshatriyas, or maybe they were from the royal family. So Karna was very depressed. But like most of us who do not get into NLUs, I would say Dronacharya was NLU maybe. Just a sec, I have, hello. any desk. So that's the same. Any desk. Audio, is it on now?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Okay. So, was I audible from the beginning?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Sir, अभी show हो रहा है, अभी एक मिनट के लिए.
Okay. Should I resume?
Sir, अभी start नहीं हुआ, मुझे अपने desk पर ना screen share कर दीजिए आप मुझे.
सेशन स्टार्टेड तो दिखा रहा है. ओके.
Hi, there seems to be some technical glitch. So just give us 10-15 seconds and we'll be back. Okay, now I guess we are on. Mr. Banerjee, please go ahead.
Perfect.
Yes,
sir. So it's visible, right?
Yes, sir. Your visible screen is also visible.
Perfect. Perfect. So as I was saying, our character is Karna to start with. Now, when Karna was not given the due kind of knowledge from Guru Dronacharya, he felt dejected. And obviously, like, you know, when we don't get into the NLUs, we also have the same kind of a feeling. But then Karna was a warrior. He went to another person called Guru Parashuram. Now, Parashuram was an equally adept warrior. But he made a declaration to Parashuram saying that he was from a Brahmin family. He did not disclose that Karna was from the Kshatriya breed or the warrior breed. And things went on. One fine day, when Guru Parashuram was very tired, he decided to take rest. And he laid on Karna's lap. And obviously he was tired, so maybe he went into deep sleep. While Guru Parashuram was sleeping, a bee came in and sat on Karna's leg and it bit him. Now Karna knew that if he moved, his Guru Parashuram would wake up. He would be disturbed, and hence, as a good disciple, as a good learner, as a good student, he endured the pain and he stood still. But later on, when Guru Parashuram woke up, he saw blood on Karna's leg, and instantly he realized that Karna had actually lied. because a Brahman was not supposed to endure such pain. He could not have done it. Hence, he became very, very angry. And he was so enraged that he cursed Karna that he will not be able to use the knowledge that he has gained from Parashuram when he needed it most. And Parashuram had actually taught him how to use the Brahmastra. And later on in the battlefield, indeed Karna did not know the trick and he was killed. So the question is, Karna was dutiful in doing what he did. Now, the moot question that arises here is, was Karna moral or he was ethical? So I think we can take a view on this as to whether Karna was moral or Karna was ethical. So if I take your poll on this, kindly share what you feel, because these two terms are very close, but they are not the same. Do you think Karna was moral or acha good? Okay. Okay, so whether he was moral or ethical, and we have okay. So I think we can close it now. And I have 51% people telling me he was ethical and 49% telling me he was moral. I would say that he was moral. Like when you become a practitioner, you know, every comma and full stop makes a difference. This is the first step that you must understand what exactly is morality and what exactly is ethics. Because most of the times when we don't understand the difference between these two terms, we get confused and we are not able to take a clear decision. So what exactly is ethics? I should be able to go to the next slide. Somehow the slide is not moving. So as a typical student of law would start with, I would also refer to the Black's Law Dictionary. This is where we all start our legal practice from. Look into the dictionary. This is what we have learned as rules of interpretation. This is the basic norm. So when I was flipping through the dictionary, when I went to the word ethics, it was explained in the most appropriate manner. Because what it says is, ethics of the profession is nothing but a consensus of experienced people who say that there is a necessity of professional standards. So if I just reiterate, it says what is generally called the ethics of the profession is but consensus of expert opinion as to necessity of professional standards. If I put it in simple words, people who have gained knowledge and experience in certain profession, they hold an opinion that there has to be some professional standards, and those professional standards consolidated make up ethics. So how is it different from moral? Well, moral does not always mean that you are ethical. Say, for instance, a lawyer who knows that his client is not right, who knows that his client is guilty, declares it to the court or declares it to the judge. So in that instance, the person is held to be a moral person because he is doing his moral duty, just like Karna was doing. Karna was being moral. 49% of you were right by saying yes, he was moral. He was doing his duty as a student. But then you are not ethical, because ethics tells you that you cannot violate attorney-client privilege. So here starts the dilemma, here starts the paradox. As of now, as students, we were very clear that if you are moral, you are ethical also. Both these things are correlated and they have a positive relation. But now you understand through these two instances that being ethical and moral may be two different scenarios. But yes, being ethical means that somewhere or the other, you need to be a good person too. But that does not mean that whenever you are listening to your inner voice, you are also listening to what your ethics have to say. Because mind it, ethics are driven by the professional standards. Morals are driven by your own conscience. So when you step into the courtroom, when you step into the arena of the corporate world, you have to be very careful when you need to be moral, when you need to follow the ethics. So this is the stepping stone. So what exactly is a profession? Now, if you see, we need morality when we are a part of the profession, or rather we need ethics when we are a part of a profession. Somebody who's selling vegetable on the road, or maybe a barber, or maybe a carpenter, they are predominantly using manual labor. Hence, they are not recognized as professionals. But any other person, like a lawyer or a doctor or a chartered accountant, is considered a professional because the person predominantly utilizes intellect. Now, here is the major demarcation between all other kind of activities and activities related to you. Because profession primarily means utilization of mental and intellectual skills. Most of your decisions are based on your intellect. Hence, a characteristics is built around. If you see the definition of profession, how does a profession evolve? What do you call a profession? I'm sure most of you will agree to these attributes, because unless if you don't have these attributes, you don't categorize anything as a profession. First and foremost is that it is an established and maintained means of providing service. A lawyer or a chartered accountant or a doctor is a benchmark in itself. The profession in itself has certain standards, And these people render service to the individual and to the society. They are also concerned with identified areas of need. Like, for instance, when you become a lawyer, you pick up a specialization. You don't go to a lawyer telling the same person that I need a remedy for a family matter, I need a remedy for a property matter, a criminal matter, altogether. Maybe he's very competent, but still, in most of the cases, based on my experience, I have seen that even if he knows the ins and out, he will say, I only deal in property matters. I will refer you to somebody who's a criminal lawyer. So this is another characteristics of a profession. Identified areas of need are being catered to. Next, the profession is a body of knowledge. Now, again, as you understand, a profession is not the bar council itself. It's not the building. It's not the books. It's not the orders. It's not the circulars. It is people like you, me. Hence, a profession is a assimilation of knowledge, but the knowledge is assimilated both in terms of the entire body of professionals and individuals. So all of them come together to create the knowledge, and that knowledge is the domain of the professionals. All decisions that you take are based on principles and theories. You have so many maxims and laws, you have so many principles. You follow them all, put to use, and then only derive at a decision. You don't flip a coin and say, okay, I think he's guilty. You do a rigorous test. A profession is obviously put into one or more associations. You have so many associations in your legal domain. You have so many associations in the medical domain. So you have your associations. Further, you have certain standards of admission. It is only when you qualify your LLB exams that you're deemed appropriate to appear for the Bar Council of India exams. And when you actually clear it, you get the license of practice. So you see, it has a performance standard. And then when you clear the standard, you are admitted to such kind of a profession. Such knowledge is imparted in schools or college. And lastly, but not the least, whenever you belong to any profession, there is a high level of public trust in you. And with more authority comes responsibility. That is why, needless to say, that the professional has to accept responsibility also. So when you lose a case, it is entirely your doing. You cannot say that the judge was wrong. Yes, maybe at times he takes a different view. But then as professionals, we have to be ready for the ultimate repercussion, I would say, and that is taking responsibility. You cannot always bask in the glory of winning a case. Every courtroom drama is not jolly LLB. So now listen to me very carefully. For those of you who want to step into the corporate world, or those of you who are already working, you need to be very conscious of certain inner inherent elements. And that is why, just like Jamal, I have put in the picture of Buddha. Now, Gautam Buddha, as we know, he was not Buddha from birth. He was a ruthless ruler. He killed so many people as Ashoka. And later on, he realized some inner truth of life. And then he became Bhagwan Buddha. He got moksha. He realized some elements which were required and cardinal for survival on this earth. So just like Gautam Buddha realized the elements that are required for a human being to survive on this planet, you as a professional must also understand what all you must have to fight the external world. It is much like your immunity system. If you don't have these ingredients in your immunity system, you will be infected by the COVID-19s of the outer world. And that is what we call as job pressure. That is what we call as politics. That is what we call as victimization, and so on and so forth. So before you actually jump into a profession, before you join Amar Chand, before you join Tata Sons, before you join any company or a firm, please run a check on whether you have these ingredients of you. And mind it, I call them job expectation. That is, all these ingredients make you fit to render the job, irrespective of which entity you join. So the first thing is, customer is king. It is a fact. Please understand that business came first, then came in law to regulate the business. We had trade first, and then trade laws were brought in. So in any case, howsoever talented you may be, you will always see that business comes first. Legalities are only a support system. You don't do a business to support law. You do a legal practice to support the business. Hence, the customer is king. True. You can't say no to him. But then there are certain other attributes which you must have also. Next is Desha Dharma. You must be dedicated and you must be conscious of your duty to the country. And how do I put it in legal sense? Let's take, for instance, all these people who have done their scams and moved out of India. Desha Dharma, or duty to the country, is nothing but territorial jurisdiction. When there is a law, we understand there are certain laws which have extraterritorial jurisdictions, which means that if a person goes to some other countries and takes an asylum, the Indian authorities do have the power to extradite him, to bring him back, bring him to justice. Hence, you must always remember that duty to the country is something which must be inherent. And duty to the country means duty to the laws of the land. You are bound by the laws of the land. Even if you are sitting in Singapore, you may have to know most of the laws of India because you are dealing with a customer in India. So Desha Dharma is one of the vital ingredients that you must have. But when you go out to the world, it is nothing but being conscious of the laws of the land. Work is worship. In today's scenario, there is nothing called a 9-to-5 job. Hence, you have to worship your job. There is too much a competition around. Hence, if you don't worship it, you will lose it. Right man for the right job. Now, you must understand that even at the assistant manager level, you will find trainees coming into the law firm or into the law department for 1 month. Most of you do it. But even for those 1 month, I have been fortunate enough to create people who have actually graduated and they are still in touch with me and they're doing quite well. And it was only those 30 days of interaction which has built the relationship. Now, you must remember that you should never ever feel that you are an assistant manager and you have no leadership capabilities. You are just a principal associate and you don't need to lead. Only the partner needs to lead. No. Please don't take this notion when you enter into the world. Reason is, everyone is a leader. you have to identify a person capable of doing something. Maybe that person does not understand law, but maybe he's very good in, you know, even setting the petition. Because when you file a petition, even paragraphing it, interlining spacing, putting a proper page markup makes a lot of difference. I have seen, or rather you will also know, that in law firms there are people specializing for doing that. There may be many softwares, but still many law firms have people who do those paper layouts or the page layouts. So maybe you have a trainee who's good in that. Use him for that. You should be a leader from day one. So right man for the right job means you should be a leader. You should be able to isolate who's good of doing what. You should be sincere. You have to be committed. You have to take responsibility. Even as a trainee, if you don't take responsibility of what you are doing, you will never be taking responsibility of what you have done when you become a lawyer. Moral conduct, yes, you have to be very moral. One of the instances is you follow POSH. Prevention of Sexual Harassment Act, as most of you know, is something to do with morality. The Nirbhaya case was only an instance. There were many, many corporates which had such policies even before the act came in. So Nirbhaya judgment is not the triggering factor of POSH. Rather, it is just one of the events. Hence, your moral nature or the moral conduct is also very important when you join the world. Next comes Jigyasa. Unless you are a keen learner, unless you have the ingredient of being inquisitive, you will not proceed. It is only when you learn, you will be able to move ahead. Efficiency. Because when you start learning, you become efficient. And when you have both knowledge and efficiency, you have the confidence of innovating. And at a later stage, when you have actually got all these ingredients in place and you have utilized them to some extent, you go up to the position of a partner or the legal counsel, or you move up the ladder. And when you move up, please don't forget people who have helped you during the earlier part of your career. And that is the time when you need to be impartial. That is the time when you need to be impartial and look at people who have helped you, look at people who are talented, look at people who are contributing. You have to take a balanced decision. So all these ingredients are actually something that you must be conscious of to excel, or at least today's world, I would say, to at least survive. Because in my humble opinion, without any of these ingredients, it is very difficult to survive in a profession. Because profession is highly demanding. So what now is professionalism? Because all these attributes we thought were a part of professional. If you don't have these, you are not a professional. But mind it, just like the difference between morale and ethics, there is a difference between job expectation, that is the ingredients you need to fulfill the job, and something called professionalism. Now, professionalism is a different story, just like ethics. And if you now see what professionalism is, you will understand it is so very closely related to your ethics. So what exactly is that? You have to be very conscious of your client's interest. So you must understand what the client needs. That is the first stepping stone of professionalism. Professionalism does not mean dressing up. It means dressing up to the occasion, being conscious. Next, we are all Indians. We will buy a shoe worth 99 rupees, but we will not buy something worth worth 100 rupees. Why? Because we are very conscious of how much we spend. That is why proper estimation of legal advice, proper estimation of the value is most important. If you don't do a proper valuation, it will be very difficult for you to retain any client. The clients will not like to be charged anytime and every time. So when we used to, work for a law firm, our primary job was to estimate how many hearings are we going to take or how many consultations are we going to need to deal with this situation. So we had to actually spend hours before replying to the client, because the first thing that the client wanted was to have an estimate. He wanted to have an estimate of what is the cost that is going to be involved. And we Indians are quite cost conscious. So this is the second step of professionalism. When you have the case, you take it to the court or the forum or the quasi judicial bodies. And there you need to understand their procedure, because you will see the Income Tax Appellate Tribunal has a totally different setup and its rules are different from the high courts. So you need to be honest and respect every court, and court includes all your quasi judicial forums. Be adequately prepared for the case. You should also be loyal to law and justice, which means that you should honor the practices of the profession. You have to be a part of the legal system to win a case. You can't do something illegal yourself. You must profess fellowship. You cannot go against your own community and win anything in life. You have to be a part of the community. You have to be fair in your dealings. You have to be very systematic and very, very updated. And that is why you have to subscribe, or you have to be on your phone. You have to look for judgments, because things change in a jiffy. You must be updated. And last but not the least, you must be prudent. That is being intelligent, and you should be diligent. So now you see the difference between professionalism and job expectation. Just like morale and ethics, these two things are totally different, because job expectations are all your inner ingredients. Professionalism is what helps you sail through the profession itself. Now, when I was a student, we all had studied, I'm sure we have all studied the paper on ethics. So one of the most relevant things that I remember today is about the seven lamps of advocacy. Now, the reason of putting in the dates is quite relevant. Why did I put in the date 2nd October 1863 to 1st December 1943? Justice Edward Parry was a British judge, and he lived till 1943, which means that is not so irrelevant. Because what happens is, the more and more educated, the more and more sophisticated we get, we feel that these are the learnings from the yesteryears and we need not follow them because they have become redundant. But still, when we study that whether a minor is capable of doing a contract or not, I have not seen any book not starting without Mohri Bibi and Dharmadas Ghosh. Why don't we start with some legal case which was decided in 1999 or maybe 2020? I'm sure there would have been cases, but we still say Mohri Bibi versus Dharmadas Ghosh. Or for that matter, when we talk about separate legal entity in case of a corporate, we will always talk about the Solomon versus Solomon case. Why? Because certain facts don't change. And seven lamps of advocacy, these seven canons are so true today. Even today, I think they are in place. And Justice Parry was very, very clear in outlining what you need to have in you when you go into the legal profession. So first is indeed honesty. You must be honest. It's not just a saying that honesty is the best policy, but as a lawyer, as a criminal lawyer, as a commercial lawyer, you have to be honest. At times you have to refuse a case. At times you have to tell your client no. Courage. You must have courage. Without courage, surviving in the legal profession is very tough, let me tell you, because you will have pressures from all four corners of the world. But if you succumb to such pressures, you will neither be ethical, and if you're not ethical, you cannot be moral. You will have sleepless nights. Hence, courage. Industry. Now, with the word industry, we may quite often get confused. But the best way to explain it is, if one ignores law, the law will ignore him, which means that you need to be updated. You must be a part of the system. You must be conscious. You must have to revisit your brief. You must prepare yourself up to the time when your case is to be heard. Hence, you have to stay updated. Wit. Now, wit does not mean being able to crack jokes. Wit means being able to present your case properly. Now, if you see or if you recall the movie Guru, now when Abhishek Bachchan was making his presentation before the enforcement directorate bench, which called him to make the presentation, and he was just back from the heart attack, he was paralyzed. But when he made the entire presentation himself, when he was presenting his case, he could do it in 2.5 minutes or maybe a bit less. Because if I recall correctly, he was given only 3 minutes to present. 3 minutes to present his side. And he did it in 2.5 minutes. And at the end of the day, he said 2.5 minutes and 3 minutes is what you gave me, or rather 3 minutes you gave me. I presented it in 2.5 minutes. Now, the difference between the time allotted and the time taken is profit. He said, this is munafa. That is wit. Wit does not mean cracking jokes. Wit means being bang on target and being able to present your case with proper justification. Eloquence, we are all masters of language. You have to be, until and unless you are capable of expressing yourself, it is very difficult to make a judgment for the judge. That's the reason we all have grown up studying so many judgments. We study judgments written by Justice Fali Nariman. We study judgments written by some Chief Justice. We study judgments written by Justice Chandrachur. Why? Because each judge, each case has a way of expressing the substratum on which the decision is made. And those knowledges that you gain from these cases help you in presenting your own case in future. Hence, eloquence is the ability to express yourself. And please keep it in mind, it is not always English. My friends who practice in Orissa, who practice in Assam, who practice in Patna, they are not so good in English, but at the same time, even court proceedings are not done in English. They are done in the regional language, but they are very, very crisp in presenting their case. Hindi mein bolni hai, boliye. Hindi, as you know, constitutionally is the national language. For all those who have joined in अगर इंग्लिश नहीं आती है, अगर गलत इंग्लिश आती है, इट इज बेटर टू स्टे अवे. यू शुड बी केपेबल ऑफ एक्सप्रेसिंग योर व्यूज इन द लैंग्वेज दैट यू आर मोस्ट thorough in. It is better to speak in Hindi rather than speak wrong English, because one wrong word from your side will actually kill the entire case. So be eloquent. Eloquent does not mean being able to speak only in a language which is worldwide accepted. It is being able to express the facts. Judgment. You should always have your own opinion. And last but not the least, again, fellowship. You are a part of the community. You are a part of the fraternity. You cannot do without them. Today you may see Mr. Chidambaram having so many grudges against the ruling party, but go to any bar council meeting or go to any party thrown by an eminent lawyer, you will see Mr. Chidambaram cracking jokes with late Mr. Arun Jaitley, or maybe even Nirmala Sitharaman. The reason is there, they are a part of the fraternity. Hence, you must understand that you are a part of the fraternity. You have to be linked with your own people. So I think it is a time. Do we have a poll question here, right? Poll 2. Yes. Now tell me, how many of you think that we can do away with any of these 7 lamps of advocacy? How many of you think? Acha. The results are coming in. Because like I told you, it was 1943 when Justice Parry passed away, and it's been quite some time. So do you really think that there is a possibility of doing away with any of these 7 lamps? Okay, we have we have 30% more to vote, but quickly please, I think your opinion counts, because when you're participating, you must have your own judgment. So 73 out of 100. Requesting all of you to okay, so I think we should call it a show now. We should stop it. So amazingly and very rightly, 66% of you think that it's not practically possible to do away with any of these 7 lamps of advocacy. But I would really want to understand people who have voted saying that courage is not required. Because all others, the way I see is, very few of you have said wit is required. Only 3% are of the opinion, and I respect your opinion, that it is not required. Maybe. But how can you survive without courage? 8% think, and it is a liberal thought process. I am again saying that I am not supporting any view, or I am not going to say that you're wrong. People who have decided, people who are professionals have decided or some parameter, but the results say 8% of you think that courage is not required. So that in a way is a new finding in itself. Still we'll move ahead, and thank you all for sharing your views, because unless you're conscious of what you're listening to, it makes no sense. So 66%, that's the major part, think that you can't do away with all the, I mean, any of the elements of the seven lamps. So now we are all conscious of how individually we need to equip yourself. हमारे अंदर क्या क्या गुण होने चाहिए, हमें क्या आना चाहिए, so that we go out to the world and survive. So today's session was more or less inclined to people who are in some kind of a contract or they are in employment, because what I have seen is, I have been in this profession for around, I told you, 16, 17 years. I was fortunate to be taught company law by Justice Shyamal Sen, who was the Chief Justice of Calcutta High Court. So I've seen people of that status. I've also been very fortunate to work in the Ministry of Corporate Affairs with Sri Arun Jaitley Ji. He was an immensely knowledgeable person. He used to be the chairman of our council. So I've seen him also. But then what I realize is, because when we started practice, or when we qualified way back 12 years, 15 years ago, there were not so organized law firms in existence. Neither the legal department in companies were so organized. It was a practice dominated profession. All lawyers used to go in for practice. But I think most of you will agree, and if you do a market analysis, today the practice component has come down, because even in law firms, you have a concept of employment. Law firms have grown in size. They have become so specialized that you now become an employee of a law firm. And when you work for a couple of years in a law firm, you switch to the industry. So the trend of being a hardcore practitioner is somehow changing nowadays. A major part of the legal professional is either working for firms like Amar Chand, Khaitan, and when they gather enough experience, they are moving on to companies like Tata's and Reliance. Or at times when they are in Tata and Reliance and they retire, after retirement, they join the law firms. So these two are the major players in the legal domain today, law firms and the corporates. So let's start with a corporate, because I told you business came in first. So let us try and understand what exactly is a corporate. Now, a corporation is nothing but an assimilation of thoughts and people like Ambani or Ratan Tata running it. We recognize a company not because of the policies, but because of the person heading it. We say a company is ethical because the company is headed by somebody like Ratan Tata or maybe Uday Kotak, because these people have created their own benchmark. So I think if for any instance the person is not there, it will be very hard for the company to survive. So it is the thought process primarily that builds a company. But legally, we have a paradox here. We have all studied the basic of contract law, law of agency, and the concept of vicarious liability. I still remember the first case law where a driver was backing a bus owned by some bus company, and the bus hit a person, and the company which owned the bus was held liable. This was the first case law that I studied way back, I think 15 years back, for vicarious liability, which means that there is an agency relationship. The principal is liable for the agent. It is a very simple rule. Now, when we apply it to a company, here also you have something called the agency theory. Now, the agency theory again says that there is a principal and there is an agent, but there is a great paradox here. Keep it in mind, it is not so simple as the Indian Contract Act or the vicarious liability. Because in case of a company, the principal or the owner is the shareholder, the directors, the KMP, that is key managerial personnel like CEO, CFO, the legal head. They are not the owners. It is the shareholder. So if I say shareholder is the principal and the directors and management includes people like you, people like a company secretary, a chartered accountant, the CFO, the management and directors are the agents. But tell me, when there is a scam in a company, that is the directors or the management or the CFO is doing a scam, which is something wrong on the part of the company, do the shareholders go to jail? No. The shareholders are not even answerable. So here lies the paradox. The agency theory, even though recognizes that there is a concept of principal and there is a concept of agent, the simple law of vicarious liability does not apply to a company setup. This is where all frictions start, because the shareholders per se cannot control the activities. They have to delegate. So when they delegate, and they delegate it to the directors and the management, people like you, me, to run the functions. But if there is something wrong, the shareholders are not responsible. It is we alone are held responsible. Here lies the triggering factor. Here we need to be careful, because the theory holds, the agency theory holds, that there will be some friction and mistrust between these two groups. Even though the shareholder is the principal and the directors are the agents, they will never trust each other totally. They can't, because somewhere or the other, they are not conscious of what is happening. They are not conscious of what is happening. For people who have studied company law will know that there is an event called the annual general meeting, which happens only once in a year. So it is only once in a year that you are hauled up and you are answerable to the shareholders. In between, there is a concept of extraordinary general meeting, and that may or may not happen. So it is only once, like your annual report card, that your father gets to see how well you are doing. But there is friction. Hence, the agency theory suggests that the management of an organization is undertaken on behalf of the owners of the organization. That is, you are working as the agents of the principal, that is shareholders. But amidst so much of friction and mistrust, how do you think companies work? Companies work because there are two set of legal duties applicable to you. You as in part of the management, because a person who's a lawyer will never join as somebody who's not a part of the management or not a part of the team. He has to be a part of a professional organization, or rather professional operation. You know, you cannot expect a lawyer to be sending notices or maybe doing the job of a courier person. He is a professional. So a professional has professional duties. So whenever we look at the management duties for a person, you have two categories. One is the fiduciary duty, the other is common law duty. And please keep it in mind when you read corporate law or whenever you read these kind of laws, it is not only for directors, it is also for people like you and me. who are a part of the management, who are officers in the company. So first fiduciary duty is to have good faith. So what is good faith is circumstantial. A person who's working for a law firm must have good faith towards its client. But when a person, when the same person is doing a due diligence, he may have to take a different role altogether. You should not misuse your powers. What is misuse is again defined by the company's domain. You must understand where the company operates, how it operates, who are the clients, to whom are you answerable. Based on that, you should never misuse the powers you have. You will never have unfettered discretion. Now, the best example is that of nominee directors in companies. Many of you would have seen that government companies or large companies have directors nominated by State Bank of India or maybe from the government itself. So these people are nominee directors. They represent the interest of the lending agency or maybe the government. So their powers are regulated by the nominator. This is the best example where even though you are a director, you do not have unfettered discretion. You cannot say yes or no unless you call up your minister. If you are a government nominee, you cannot say no unless you call up a senior person in SBI. If you are a representative of SBI. So unfettered discretion is something which you don't have. It is a fiduciary duty. Somewhere or the other, you are bound by some kind of string of control. Lack of conflicting interest. Obviously, you cannot have conflicting interest. You must give continuous disclosures. That is why when you go to any company, irrespective whether you are a director or not, when you work in the legal department, you will see you will be required to give some kind of disclosures. When you take up a case, say when you are taking up a case, when you're joining a company, you will have to give disclosures that I was not related to this party or none of my relatives are working in this company. You have to give non-compete disclosures. You have to tell them that when I quit this job, I will not go into competition. You cannot use company's property for your own gain. Section 452 of the Companies Act puts an embargo that when you are leaving the company, you have to give up your rights of the property allotted to you by the company. So these are mainly fiduciary duties. Further, you have common law duties. Common law duties emerge from the common law because common law system is nothing but a part of business. So you have to act within the powers of the company. So where do the powers come from? So when you say you have to work within the powers of the company, company would also include a law firm. So a law firm, when it is appointed to do a job, will have a term sheet. Whenever you're given any kind of an assignment in a law firm, be it a due diligence, be it a merger, be it an acquisition, be it defending somebody in a criminal case, you will always have a term sheet. In case of a company, it is the memorandum or association, or it is the agreement, it is the shareholders agreement. So all these agreements, term sheets, define the ambit of your power. You have to work within that ambit. You must be able to exercise independent judgment. Just like a professional, I told you, depending on the precedents, depending on the theories, you should be able to take a judgment. You should delegate, because one of the key ingredients that is required to become a good employee is being able to understand who is a good resource. So you must delegate, but at the same time, delegation has to be done with due care. If you give a brief to your junior to make a photocopy and then just proofread it, and somehow he leaves one of the photocopies on the Xerox machine, you will be held responsible. Things like these happen practically. And lastly, not the least, confidentiality, be it your own friend, your family, you cannot disclose what is happening in your professional domain. So these are just summations of the fiduciary and common law duties, but at least I think you will have some kind of notion as to how the agency theory, irrespective of so many flaws, irrespective of so many Cyrus mystery episodes, the Infosys episode, companies ousting their chairman still survive. They survive because people like you and me are bound by these duties, fiduciary and common law duties, because a company will go on forever. Again, we had a very favorite question which used to say, it was based on separate legal entity and perpetual succession. It used to say that men may come and men may go, but a company goes on forever. Indeed. So how does a company go on forever? It is because of you people understand the fiduciary duty and comply with the common law duty. Now, why do we fail to be ethical? You know, ethics is something which is mandatory. Moral is something that you imbibe through birth. So both of them are required. But at times you will see lapses. Why does it happen? First, self-interest. You're not bothered about what is happening in the company. You're only bothered about your next raise. You're only bothered about what you can gain. So if you don't look at the larger picture, you may compromise. Fear. To some extent, now I understand why some said courage is not required, or maybe it can be done away with, because in today's COVID environment, most of us are worried about our jobs. We don't think of ethics. We don't think of morality. But please keep it in mind, if you are compromising now, it is all written and documented. Later on, when things are hauled up, when things go to the enforcement directorate, when things go to the enforcing agencies, you or anybody else will be in trouble. Hence, fear is a determining factor. If you are afraid, you may be unethical. Self-deception. The best way to elucidate is when you watch any Hindi movie and you see the criminal or the villain coming back home who has a very highly ethical and moral wife. I mean, the man is always a bad person, but the wife is highly ethical and she is highly devoted to God and she is praying. And the moment the man enters the house, the wife has one question. Aap aisa kyun karte ho? Why do you do all these bad things? Don't you see our kid? And the kid is always sleeping. Don't you see his future? He will grow up to be a criminal like you. And what does that man say? The man has a simple answer. Dear, I am doing all for you. Main apne liye kahan kar raha hu? I am not doing it for myself. I am doing it for you, my family, my kid. This is the best example of self-deception. He is deceiving himself by telling his family that all the wrong deeds are for the betterment of the family. When you're self-deceiving, you are being unethical. Microscopic vision is again related to self-interest. You don't want to see what is happening. You're only worried about your job. Acceptance of authority. Yes, at times you have no other option. You have to accept what your boss is saying. And if your boss is right, you have to comply. Herd mentality. If others are doing it, I also have to do it. There are many examples wherein people in government offices, people in the industry had to do what the peers were doing. Herd mentality is the reflection of peer pressure. If others are doing, you also need to do it. Ignorance. You don't know what is wrong and what is right. So out of ignorance, you're doing something unethical. And lastly, communication failure. Now, this is something which is very important for each of you, because most of the time We don't know whom to communicate, whom to write a letter, to whom should we share our grievances. So many a times, you know, you write to a person, the person does not reply, or you don't get a favorable reply, you stop your initiative then and there. That is the reason you will see most of the telecom companies having a hierarchy. You have a first level, then you have a second level, then you have the ombudsman. Then if you don't have any kind of redressal, you go to the telecom authority. So these hierarchies have been put into place in most of banking sectors also, because everybody is conscious that the lowest level person may not be equipped to give you the remedy. Hence, you should not give up, because once you stop communicating, you accept something which is happening around you, and that may be unethical. So these are the factors which make you compromise. Now, it's a very tough job nowadays. You know,
a very gentle reminder to sir. So we have completed our scheduled time.
Right.
We can just rush it up a bit.
Yeah, flash it up. Right, I'll do that. So it's a very difficult job nowadays, you know, to take a call that I want to raise the red flag. I am conscious. I have got up today morning. Yesterday, I had dreams that, you know, you should be a very good person. And today I am in office and I want to raise my voice. Raising your voice has to be thought through process. You can't do like in films. It's not a 3-hour job. It's not Jolly LLB that you can win a case in 3 hours. It may cost you your life. It may cost you your job. So taking a few instances, bring it to the practical table. All this that I've told you is required, but let's take a few practical examples. Number one was the Supreme Court case of Rafael Deal. Now, what happened was the Hindu, which is a well-known publication, issued some facts and figures about the Rafael deal. Now, the counsel for the government of India, Sri Venu Gopal, actually said that the Rafael deal was a government deal, which we all know, and it invoked certain sections of Official Secrets Act. Now, let me tell you, Official Secrets Act 1923 was enacted by the Britishers so that they could hold back every information they wanted not to share. Now, Official Secrets Act is also an exception to the Rights of Information Act, because anything guarded by official secrets will not be given out in RTI. So Mr. Venugopal started arguing that, you know, all that has been published in the Hindu magazine or the Hindu paper is covered by the Official Secrets Act, and hence the Hindu editor should be held guilty. And what was the sentence? It was something between 3 to 14 years of imprisonment. But then here lies the official silver lining. Like I told you, you should never stop communicating. You should keep on fighting. The then Chief Justice of India, Sri Gogoi, came out with a different judgment altogether. He said that the right of such publication would be covered under the constitutional guarantee of freedom of speech. Hence, even certain matters where government is involved and government is a party can be brought out to the public. So those of you who are thinking of raising a voice against such kind of issues should refer to this judgment by Sri Gogoi, wherein he demarcated between the Official Secrets Act and the constitutional freedom of speech. Moving on, when you enter into a company, you will be part of the legal team. Now, the legal team has major information. You want to do a merger, the legal team has to do it. You want to buy a company, the legal team will be doing the due diligence. You want to hire a highly decorated person as an employee, the legal team will be vetting the credentials. So every time the legal team has information, and that information in commercial term is called unpublished price sensitive information. Now this unpublished price sensitive information is like a time bomb. because SEBI, which is the market regulator, defines such information to be price sensitive, which means it will impact the price of the company's share prices. And it gives a small description to it, says something which only impacts dividend, change in capital, merger, demerger, but it is not restricted, which means that these instances are only illustrative. Anything and everything which impacts the price of the shares in a company will be unpublished price sensitive information. And there is indeed a huge penalty involved, which says it can be minimum 1 lakh and can go up to 1 crore. So people who are joining the legal department need to be very careful of these instances. One of these mistakes that was made very recently in 2019 was by the former legal head of Apple. Now, he himself was actually in charge of taking care of preventing insider trading, and he was guilty of insider trading himself. Not only did he lose his job, but he also had to pay a huge penalty, and criminal charges were also brought against him, because in US, insider trading to some extent is also held to be a criminal offense. So yes, as lawyers, we are all human beings. Now, how and when to decide that you need to blow the whistle? See, every problem is not material. Materiality is a concept which is usually used in accounting. If there is a difference of 1 rupee or 0.5, what do? We round it off because it is not material. But if there is a problem which is really material, recognize it. So this is your checklist of when you should blow the whistle. First, recognize the problem. At all, is it material? Next, do a lot of fact finding. Gather information. Don't be half prepared. Generate alternative solutions. When you're working for your boss, you just can't say no. You must give solutions. You are a professional. You are not hired at a 5 lakh rupee package just to say no. You have to give them a way out. Hence, third most important step, generate alternative solutions. Evaluate the cost. Because like I told you, not only you, but your client, your boss, everything depends on cost. When you see the cost, decide and take the one which is giving you the optimum output and then implement. So it may seem very easy. All these 6 steps are very easy. But when in the heat of the moment, you have to be very, very categorical in first identifying the issue, whether at all it is material or not. And if it is material, please go on with all these steps and decide whether you want to blow the whistle. Now, when we talk of Whistleblower Act, we all know about the Whistleblower Act 2014. Unfortunately, the Whistleblower Act 2014 never took off, because in 2015, there were certain amendments which were proposed, but the proposed amendments actually made some, I'll complete this slide and I have a small poll for you also. So what happened in 2015 is the act was again supposed to be amended, and there were certain changes that were proposed. And unfortunately, the changes actually brought those whistleblowers out in the daylight. So I do have a video of around 2 minutes, but because of paucity of time, I will not show it now. Rather, when we upload this entire presentation, you can watch it on your own. And there were certain questions related to it. Like somebody asked me, what is the status of whistleblowing? How is RTI and whistleblowing connected? Or whether RTI was a negative thing? So you will get all the answers in the video. But like I was saying about Whistleblower Protection Act, we know that there is an act. But unfortunately, let me tell you, practically, it is not applicable. It is not operational. Because in 2015, an amendment was brought in which said that, yes, they want to change something. And when it wanted to change certain attributes, it wanted to safeguard disclosures which were related to sovereignty Integrity of India, much like the Official Secrets Act. But that exposed or that reduced the immunity of a whistleblower. A whistleblower could also be prosecuted. So please do watch the video. You will have 2-3 instances where a person who's working on a government department wanted to blow the whistle, but then the moment he blew it, he was also susceptible to be prosecuted against. Hence, after this 2015 amendment was put into the Lok Sabha, it went to the Rajya Sabha, but the Rajya Sabha was dissolved in 2016. And since then, this Whistleblower Act is still in a limbo. It is not operational to that extent. I would request the third poll to be taken by you in a ziffy so that I can conclude my session in the next 5-10 minutes. So if I may request my audience to take the third poll. And it is based on how you should blow the whistle or the checklist of whistleblowing. Ah, great. So I know, acha. People are... Okay, this is quite interesting. So should I stop it? I think 4:44. Now let's stop it. So I have 73% of people, 73% of my audience giving the right answer. Yes, please keep it in mind. Again, I'm telling you, blowing the whistle means saying no to something, but if you don't give an alternative, why do you think you will be hired? You have to find a solution before saying no. You must have an alternative in hand. Only then you should blow the whistle. So please do go through the last slide, that is slide 14 again, so that you understand how you practically deal with the situation. So now we know that the Whistleblower Act has not taken up practically. This is the film that I wanted to show you, but it's a 5-minute film. I will not go through it right now. You can watch it on the YouTube or wherever the film is there in the PPT. I'll move on with the next and the last part. So now we must also understand that whistleblower protection is not very effective in India. But as a corporate employee, say you join a corporate, how are you protected? Somebody asked me about the corporate governance scenario. Somebody asked me about the audit committee also. Now, I would only like to highlight one point here. In corporates, we have a concept of audit committee. Now, the audit committee is primarily concerned about audit of accounts, but eventually they have also been given the responsibility of vigil mechanism. Now, vigil, by the word, it is clear, means keeping an eye. Now, when you want to keeping an eye on somebody, it is done through the audit committee. However, please keep it in mind, an audit committee under Section 177 of the Companies Act is required for a listed company. It is mandatory, or from a company which accepts public deposits, or from any company which has taken loans up to 50 crores or more. Now, please keep it in mind, private companies, that is companies which have taken loan of say 49 crores are outside the ambit of whistleblowing or outside the ambit of Section 177. Hence, private companies which have a low borrowing do not need to have an audit committee. Hence, it is not mandatory to have a vigil mechanism. Independent directors. Thankfully, after the Companies Act, independent directors are also held responsible for implementing vigil mechanism. They are also required to maintain a record. They are also responsible. But again, independent directors are required for listed and large companies. private companies don't need it. So there are a couple of other sections also, like 208 and 210, wherein the government is empowered to actually check the operations of the company. And through these sections, the government can check what is happening. And you can actually, as a whistleblower, write to the central government. You can write to the Ministry of Corporate Affairs. SEBI also provides that under the regulations of listing, you must have a vigil mechanism. And lastly, the auditors or the external auditors have been bestowed powers under companies audit rules of 2020 to actually investigate into the vigil mechanism and report how many complaints were received. So you see, this is a very small kind of a framework that you have in India for whistleblowers. But there were very big instances like the ICICI case and Infosys. Both of the cases were triggered by whistleblowers. What do you have in a whistleblowing mechanism? These are a few of the ingredients that you must read in your whistleblower policy, whether or not these ingredients are there in the policy. If either of these ingredients are missing in your policy, please take it from me that it is a very risky proposition to blow the whistle in that entity, because these are the cardinal rules that you must have. To end with the silver lining. Till now, I have been telling you all that is true and existing and has never given you a very good feedback. It has never given you a feeling of elation. You have never felt good that yes, through whistleblowing and being ethical, things can be right. But that is not the case. Like an icing on the cake, and where you put the cherry after you bake it, you know, you put the cherry on the top. That's the last step. This is the last step I had reserved for today. The case is that of Dinesh Thakur. Dinesh Thakur was a very well-placed person in Ranbaxy. Now, what happened in 2016, Dinesh Thakur was working for Ranbaxy, and all of you would know that Ranbaxy was sold to Daiichi, but it was a Japanese group. So after Daiichi took over, there was a claim of 500 million. They had to do some settlements. So Ranbaxy's whistleblower, Mr. Dinesh Thakur, he was an employee just like you and me. So Dinesh Thakur decided to blow the whistle wherein certain results were being fudged. So he went to the Supreme Court and he filed a public interest litigation. But unfortunately, the Chief Justice of India, the then Chief Justice, had this to say. Number one, he asked about the locus standi. How was a foreign citizen, because Dinesh Thakur was based in London, he came to India because Ranbaxy was an Indian company. And he filed a case in India, but then Dinesh Thakur's proposition was challenged by Chief Justice by saying, you are here from overseas and what is your locus standi? Why do you at all bring this case here? And he also said that you are coming here for academic issues, because his whistleblower blowing was seen to be an academic issue. And he simply said that, look, we have people who are languishing in jails, criminal cases going on, and we do not have time in India to go through all these academic ventures. And you should have gone to the high courts, you should have gone to some other forums. Coming to the Supreme Court, filing a PIL on this issue seems frivolous. But then, this is what happened to Dinesh Thakur. It's a video which I would recommend for all of you to watch. Dinesh Thakur, I'll just play it for 1 second on the relevant part, so that you know you can.
Criminal violations. Another arm of the FDA was $600 million in the first 6 months. David,
so the is
worse were complicit in the activities of this firm. Ranbaxy's new owners say they've spent. So we traveled. This facility has run into serious problems with the FDA. And a failure to investigate problems.
Okay.
Ranbaxy declined our request for an interview, but in a statement said, Ranbaxy is committed to providing high quality, affordable drugs to patients in the US and will take all measures to keep facilities in full compliance to all regulations.
It's a very long and lonely process.
As for Dinesh Thakkar, his findings led Ranbaxy to plead guilty to 7 felonies for exposing the company. He was awarded $49 million in the US court. Somewhere in.
I am sure all of you have heard of the figure. Dinesh Thakkar was awarded $49.8 million. This is the prize that you get for blowing whistle. His case did not sustain in India. It was rejected by the Supreme Court of India. However, he did not give up. He went to the US FDA, that is the Federal Drug Agency, and the US FDA initiated all the investigations. Then even the Indian authorities had to do it. And after that, the company paid up $500 million. And as a whistleblower, Dinesh Thakkar was rewarded $49.8 million. Now, this is what actually whistleblowing means today. The US Act, called the US Dodd-Frank Wall Street Act, which is a part of the corporate governance regime, actually brings in a concept of whistleblowing protection. It says that whistleblowers will be given protection, just like Dinesh Thakkar was rewarded. There is a provision of rewarding. The same thing has been brought into India recently in 2019. So those of you who want to blow the whistle should go through this. Office of Information Protection has been created by SEBI in 2019. However, please keep it in mind, this Office of Information Protection only deals with instances of insider trading. That is, if you are aware of any kind of insider trading where the money involved could go up to 5 crores or more, you can blow the whistle and you will be protected under the Office of Information Protection. And if you can prove it, you have a prize money of 1 crore waiting for you. But again, I'm repeating, the Office of Information Protection brought in by SEBI does not relate to all instances of whistleblowing. All unethical practices are not covered. It is only related to insider trading. So to end with, I would say this is what you need to do in life. I think we have run over time.
Thank you, sir, for the insightful lesson. I hope our attendees do not make the mistake that Karan made in your story.
Right.
This is very relevant for our times. Thank you, sir.